You that we can meet together. God, I know too that, Lord, all things are under your control ultimately. And God, we just need to fully trust in you. And Lord, may our worship just be a sweet sound in your ear this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. Here we go.
Love.
You can sit if you'd like. Thank you. Thank you, Jesus. You are David's root, the lamb who died to ransom us. Free us from sin. Thank you, Jesus. We can't comprehend the price that you paid, but we thank you. Let us spend our lives thanking you. And we thank you for your word this morning, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen.
Good morning. Just had a verse here that reminded me that 1 Corinthians 2 says, "No eye has seen, no ear has heard, no mind has conceived what God has prepared for those who love him." And it's interesting. I've been doing some, you know, landscaping and stuff at home, and just, you know, looking at the flowers, the shrubs, the things we've got, the trees, and it's like, man, this is just so beautiful, you know. Even though it's a broken world, it's still an absolutely gorgeous world. You know, going to the coast and different things, and then you read that and thinking, oh my goodness, it can get so much better. And the Bible says that we can't even conceive what God has in store for us. Wow. Let's pray. Father God, I thank you so much, Lord. I thank you that we're in your building. Lord, I thank you for our church family, Father God. Lord, I lift up those who can't be here, Lord. I just pray for them, Lord. And again, I just continue to keep us safe, Father. And just be with those who aren't feeling well, Lord. I just pray for Bill, Lord, that I think he's about finished with his isolation quarantine, Lord. I just thank you again for how he got through that so easily. And for Millie, Lord, just her recovery, Father. And just again, Lord, I just thank you, Lord, that that we're here today, Lord. I just thank you that Gary and Colleen are back, Lord. It's just that they had safe travels. And Lord, it's just what a blessing, Lord, again, to be together with our family in your house. Amen. So again, not a whole lot to report other than just kind of, you know, our Sundays are just a little bit different right now. But again, we're here and most of our seats are full. That's awesome. Hopefully pretty soon we'll, you know, if we have to flow downstairs, we can do that too. And you did notice that we do have our communion cups. We'll be taking communion this afternoon, you know, later on after the service too. And if you haven't seen these little cups, the crackers in the top, you pull the first layer, there's your cracker. The second layer, there's the juice. So anyways, we'll get to that here in a little bit. But box in the back, if you didn't give online or something, there's a box back there to put it in. And we'll make sure Lori gets that to get the deposit and stuff done. But everybody just take a brief moment to get up and stretch and give everybody a big air hugs and that. And so we love you all.
Okay. Well, it's good to hear the Lord answering our prayers, isn't it? What an encouragement and a reminder that he is there and he listens. And the small ones or the big ones, it doesn't matter. They're all small stuff to him. And so praise the Lord for that. Let's pray. Father, thank you for this time together, Lord. And we just continue to lift up our church to you, Lord, and ask for your protection and for unity and for your love, Lord, not only for each other, but for the world around us as well. There's so much anger. There's so much pain going on right now, Lord. And we want to be that light that shines in the darkness. And so, God, we just pray for our church, lift it up to you, Lord, and pray for your blessing upon us. And we pray for your word today, Lord, as we look in and study this book, Lord, that you would bless it in Jesus' name. Amen. So we're probably going to hold off on Wednesdays for a while until things settle down a little bit. I just feel like that's kind of the best thing to do right now. So we're going to hold off on our Wednesday evening study and just do Sundays for the time being, especially since we have to, you know, clean, disinfect and after every service and all of that. So, hang in there. Bear with us on that. And hopefully eventually we'll get back to Wednesdays, maybe in the fall when things get back to normal. So we're in the book of Revelation now, so you can turn to chapter 16, countdown to eternity, as we continue to work through this incredible book, getting done with these last judgments now, the bold judgments, And if we go to the next slide, we're in chapter 16, and this is our third installment in chapter 16. As we study the seven bowl judgments, these final bowl judgments, as we said, are going to be so bad, they're going to shake the earth to its core, to its very core. And going to the next slide, the focus of this final wrath are on those who take the mark of the beast and worship his image. And this is the final judgment against unbelievers, against the earth dwellers, against the Antichrist, and against his own, all those in rebellion against God. And so going to the next slide, we already looked at the first bowl, which was loathsome sores on people, on those who take the mark of the beast and who worship his image. The second bowl was the sea turns to blood and all living creatures in the sea are going to die. The third bowl, the waters turn to blood, that is the fresh waters and the rivers and all. The fourth bowl, men are scorched by the heat of the sun. The fifth bowl, darkness on the Antichrist's throne, and then pain because of the previous bowl judgments. And the sixth bowl that we looked at last time was the Euphrates drying up. And this was, remember, to prepare the way for the kings of the east, for the kings of the rising sun, literally, to be gathered into the Middle East for the battle of Armageddon. And boy, isn't it interesting how China is rearing its ugly head right now. I mean, every day you're hearing about them in the news, and they want to be a world power, and indeed they are. And so that's going to have its total fulfillment during this sixth bowl judgment. And then today we're going to look at the seventh bowl, and that is the earth is shaken. And so now we get to part three, going to the next slide, right? Of the seven bowl judgments, we're studying verses 17 through the end of the chapter as we look at the last of the last seven bowl judgments. This is the seventh bowl that we're looking at today. We're taking it by itself, and it's easy to read through these verses and think, well, it's just another judgment. It's just another one of the judgments. Well, it's not. This is the seventh and final judgment. God is going to take out the stops on this one. And it's easy to read through it and just think, oh, it's just another thing. But it's not. I mean, it's going to be major. So let's take a look. Chapter 16, verse 17. And then the seventh angel poured out his bowl into the air. And a loud voice came out of the temple of heaven from the throne saying, "It is done." And then there were noises and thunderings and lightnings. And there was a great earthquake, such a mighty and great earthquake as had not occurred since men were on the earth. Verse 19. Now the great city was divided into three parts, and the cities of the nations fell. And great Babylon was remembered before God to give her the cup of the wine of the fierceness of his wrath. And then, verse 20, every island fled away, and the mountains were not found. And great hail from heaven fell upon men, each hailstone about the weight of a talent. Men blasphemed God because of the plague of the hail, since that plague was exceedingly great. Whew. Wowie. Wowie, wowie. So number seven in your outline, if you're taking notes today, the seventh bowl, the earth is shaken. The earth is shaken. Verse 17 again. And then the seventh angel poured out his bowl into the air, and a loud voice came out of the temple of heaven from the throne saying, "It is done." And again, that loud voice from the temple in heaven is none other than God himself. We already talked about this previously. And he says, "It is done." What does that remind us of? Yeah, Jesus on the cross. It is finished. Jesus on the cross. There on the cross, it was about Jesus being the sacrifice for our sins. Here, it's about the rejection of that sacrifice and the judgment that follows. And how interesting it is that this seventh bowl, this last bowl, is poured out into the air. We're reminded in the Bible of who the prince of the power of the air is. Over in Ephesians 2, verse 1. You can go to the next slide. There we are. And you he made alive who were dead in trespasses and sins, in which you once walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the what? The air. And the spirit who now works in the sons of disobedience. And so Satan is called a prince here. He's not called a king, because there's only one King of Kings and one Lord of Lords. But he is a prince, and he does have powers. Powerful powers. Limited powers, but he has powers. And going to the next slide, Satan has the power over some illnesses. In some sense, Satan has power over death. Satan also has power over some people. The sons of disobedience, referred to here in Ephesians 2:2, are those who have not trusted Christ as Lord and Savior. The demons are also under the rule of Satan, and one of his titles is the Prince of Demons. And Satan does have a kingdom, he does have a throne, and the whole world, according to John, is under his sway. So he is a prince with a certain amount of power. But getting back to Ephesians 2 again, it says, according to the prince of the power of the air. And the air probably refers to the invisible realm where Satan and his demons move and exist around the air, around the earth. However, having said that, I believe this judgment is going to be on the physical air itself. I take these judgments literally, not symbolically or allegorically. So far, these bowl judgments have been poured out on man with boils, on the sea with blood, on the waters with blood, on the sun with heat, and on the earth in general. These are literal plagues. They're not symbolic of something else. And this one is on the air which people breathe. No wonder Jesus said, if these days had not been cut short, no flesh would survive. I think it's safe to say that by the time this seventh angel pours out his bowl, it will be close to the end of the tribulation period, and not many people are going to be left on earth. Certainly not after this bowl is poured out, as we're going to see here. So verse 18, and there were noises and thunderings and lightnings, and there was a great earthquake, such a mighty and great earthquake. Mighty and great together here, two different words, mighty and great, emphasizing how big this is. A mighty and great earthquake as had not occurred since men were on the earth. This is going to be the mother of all earthquakes. This is going to be bad, folks. It's going to be global. It's going to be a worldwide shaking of the earth. Jesus said that in the last days, there would be earthquakes in various places, right? Well, going to the next slide, in the last 120 years or so, you can see how the amount of earthquakes, 5.6 and higher, has increased quite dramatically. And going to the next slide, the largest recent earthquake was recorded on May 22nd, 1960 in southern Chile. And it was assigned a magnitude of 9.5 on the Richter scale. And it's referred to as the Great Chilean Earthquake. And the government down there estimated that 2 million people were left homeless from this earthquake. Most of the damage and the deaths were caused by a series of tsunamis, and that were generated by this earthquake, causing 38-foot swells, 38-foot waves. And those tsunamis traveled across the Pacific Ocean at over 200 miles per hour, reaching Hawaii around the 15th hour, and causing severe damage in Hawaii and deaths there, reaching all the way to the other side of the Pacific, to the Philippines, and causing death there as well. And of course, going to the next slide, who can forget that one? Back in 2004 in the Indian Ocean, a 9.2 on the Richter scale, which caused the tsunami that killed 230,000 people. Amazing, amazing devastation. But this earthquake in Revelation during the seventh bowl is going to make those look small. It's going to make those look tiny, and this one is going to be global, felt around the world. And everything that can be shaken will be shaken. Hebrews 12:26. At that time, his voice shook the earth, but now he has promised, once more I will shake not only the earth, but also the heavens. The words once more indicate the removing of what can be shaken, that is, created things, so that what cannot be shaken may remain. Verse 28, therefore, since that's true, therefore, since we are receiving a kingdom that cannot be shaken, let us be thankful and so worship God acceptably with reverence and awe, for our God is a consuming fire. Amen. So the entire world is going to experience this mighty mega earthquake. And that's the Greek word megas. Mighty mega. Amazing. The Old Testament prophets talk about this kind of thing. One in particular is very interesting. Isaiah 24:20. Isaiah says, the earth shall reel to and fro like a drunkard, and shall totter like a hut. Its transgression shall be heavy upon it, and it will fall and not rise again. It's possible that what this is talking about here is a fundamental change in the earth, in its orbit, in its axis even. The earth, if we go to the next slide, is currently slanted to 23.5 degrees. But there's evidence on Earth that in the past, the Earth has shifted from its original axis. And if that happened, that would cause catastrophic results. A shift in the polar axis could move a region over 1,600 miles, either north, south, east, or west. And so a tropical region might suddenly and violently be 50 below zero. And so it's very possible, folks, that what God is doing through these judgments, remember, all things work together for good. It's possible what God is doing through these judgments, besides judging the world, is he's restoring the earth to its pre-flood condition for the millennial reign of Christ. Are you following? So God is going to take these judgments and restore the earth and renew the earth, but the earth is going to be different. This earth is not going to rise again. It's going to be a different earth. The old earth as we know it will be done. Going to the next slide, NASA has also confirmed that the earth's weakened magnetic field is a precursor to a reversal of the magnetic poles. That's interesting, and that we could see a magnetic pole shift, which means when you take out your compass, it'll point south instead of north. Now, right now, the north magnetic pole has been shifting to the east at about 35 miles per year. And you can see it on this chart how far magnetic north has shifted to the east over the last 35 years. National Geographic writes this. You can go to the next slide. Magnetic North's routine plod has shifted into high gear, sending it galloping across the northern hemisphere, and no one can entirely explain why. The changes have been so large that scientists began working on an emergency update for the World Magnetic Model, the mathematical system that lays the foundations for navigation from cell phones and ships to commercial airlines. So however God uses this mighty mega earthquake and whatever is involved in it, we won't know until it happens, it will be catastrophic, shaking the earth to its very core. That's why I say there's a lot packed into this last bowl judgment. It is severe. And so now in verse 19, now the great city was divided into three parts, and the cities of the nations fell, and great Babylon was remembered before God to give her the cup of the wine of the fierceness of his wrath. And notice the fierceness of his wrath. That's the two Greek words for anger, and they're both used together here. One is themos is a passionate, emotional anger, and orge is a settled anger, a decision anger, if you will. And both are involved here, and that's because it is done. God's final wrath is poured out on the earth. And the great city mentioned here is Jerusalem, and it's going to be divided into three parts. And in the context, that would be from this mighty mega earthquake. So because of this earthquake, Jerusalem is going to be divided into three parts. And we do remember from the prophets that when Jesus comes again, he's going to set his feet on the Mount of Olives, and it's going to split in half. Zechariah 14:4. And in that day, his feet, capital H, will stand on the Mount of Olives, which faces Jerusalem on the east, and the Mount of Olives shall be split in two, from east to west, making a very large valley. Half of the mountain shall move toward the north, and half of it toward the south. So this earthquake apparently will cause Jerusalem to divide into three, and the Mount of Olives and then the other part of Jerusalem, so three parts in all. And apparently it's going to be from Jesus setting his feet on the Mount of Olives. And the cities of the earth are going to fall. Going to the next slide, you can imagine how some of the greatest skyscrapers will just topple over from this mega earthquake. The tallest building in the world is in Dubai. It's about 2,800 feet tall. We've already witnessed the Twin Towers coming down. Of course, that wasn't an earthquake. But man's so-called greatness can be brought down easily by God. And Great Babylon is mentioned here as being judged. We're going to get to that more in chapter 17 and 18, which is a continuation of this judgment. But suffice it to say, Babylon is, as spoken of here in Revelation, Babylon is the rebellious world system against God. That's what's being judged in these bold judgments. It's the rebellious system against God. And this is what this seventh bowl is judging. So chapter 17 and 18 will be a continuation of this. We're going to get more details about Babylon and how it's judged. Verse 20. Then every island fled away and the mountains were not found. What do we do with that one? Wow. I mean, is that poetic language? I don't think so. Is it allegoric? Hardly, not in the context. Everything in this context is literal. The world is going to be shaken to its core. The earth as we know it is going to be changed, folks. The millennial reign of Christ over this earth is going to be a somewhat restored earth after all of this judgment takes place. Things are going to be different. People are going to live long lives again. And by long, I mean the Bible says a person that's 100 years old is going to be thought to be a child. The wolf is going to dwell with the lamb. The cow and the bear are going to graze together. Their young are going to lie down together. And the lion will eat straw like the fox. So it's going to be a different earth, a changed earth that Jesus is, and we are going to rule over. But this final judgment is not over yet. Verse 21. And great hail from heaven fell upon earth, each hailstone about the weight of a talent. And men blasphemed God because of the plague of the hail, since that plague was exceedingly great. And so again, over and over in this chapter, it says, men do not repent. One bold judgment after another. Men do not repent. A talent, each one of these hailstones is a talent. A talent back then, based on the culture, was anywhere from 75 to 130 pounds. And so let's just round it off at 100 pounds. According to the historian Josephus, the Romans catapulted stones weighing a talent into Jerusalem in 70 AD when they captured the city of Jerusalem and leveled it. 100-pound rocks were being hurled into Jerusalem. No wonder so many Jews were killed during that plague, so to speak. Now, going to the next slide, the largest hailstones up to this point have been about 2 to 3 pounds and about 9 inches across. That's a far cry from 100 pounds. You can only imagine a 100-pound block of ice hitting the roof of your house. I mean, what would that do? Going to the next slide, it wouldn't stop. It would just come right on through. And based on the values, a 100-pound hailstone would be about 20 or so inches in diameter and travel about 300 miles an hour when it hit the earth. And this part of this bold judgment is like the seventh plague of Egypt, which fell, but Pharaoh did not repent and he hardened his heart. See, history repeats itself. And it's interesting, you know, because I remember growing up, you know, you didn't go to the store and get bags of ice cubes. You went to the store and you got blocks of ice. Anybody remember that? You went to the store and you got blocks of ice, and they were 25-pound or 50-pound blocks of ice. And these things were heavy, you know? And that's what you put in your cooler, were these blocks of ice to keep your food cool. Or some people back then still had ice boxes. Ice boxes were literally, you put a block of ice in there and it kept your food cool. That's where refrigerators came from. But these, can you imagine these blocks of ice, thinking about those blocks, falling on your house? Wow. Look at the verse again. Verse 21, and men blasphemed God because of the plague of the hail, since the plague was exceedingly great. They blasphemed God. In other words, they know that this is a judgment from God, and they blaspheme him. So again, these are those who have taken the mark of the beast and who have worshipped his image, and instead of repenting, they're angry. And I can imagine that some of the anger that is going to be involved, besides the pain and everything that's going on, is their way of life has been interrupted. Their standard of living is no longer there. And they're angry at God. And I can't help but think of this pandemic, folks, and how it's interrupted our lifestyles. And people are angry. They're angry at the pandemic. They're angry at the government. They're angry at each other. They're angry at everybody. Go to the store and you run the risk of somebody yelling at you, either because you're wearing a mask or because you're not wearing a mask. They'll yell at you for both reasons. I mean, it's amazing. People are angry right now. Things have been interrupted. You hear it all the time. I'm sick of this. I'm sick of watching it on the news. I'm sick of hearing about it. I'm sick of it. I'm not going to do it anymore. People are angry right now. But it's interesting. What is the penalty for blaspheming God in the Old Testament? Stoning to death. Stoning to death. Leviticus 24:16, and whoever blasphemes the name of the Lord shall surely be put to death. All the congregation shall certainly stone him. the stranger as well as him who is born in the land. When he blasphemes the name of the Lord, he shall be put to death. Not only the Jews, but the strangers as well. This shows us how God takes blasphemy against him. And the word blasphemes there literally means to pierce, as with a sword. And those who pierce God, those who curse God, those who blame God for these woes. Wolverd writes in his commentary, "The question is sometimes raised why eternal punishment is eternal. And the answer is that people in the hardness of their hearts will not change. They deserve eternal punishment because they are eternally unrepentant." And that's what we're seeing here in the book of Revelation and what will happen in the tribulation period. And that's the bad news. But J. Vernon McGee talks about the good news. And he says this, "Again, let me repeat that the church is not a part of this scene. The church is not going through the time of Jacob's trouble. God has two ways of saving people in the Great Tribulation. First, saving them out of it by taking them out of the world as he took Enoch before the flood, before the judgment of the flood. And second, by saving them in it as he preserved the life of Noah during the flood. God will definitely save people during the days of the Great Tribulation, but the church will not be a part of that, for it will have been taken from the earth before the tribulation begins." Amen to that. And Maranatha, Lord, come quickly. Come quickly for your church, Lord. We're waiting. We're here and we're watching. Let's pray. Thank you, Lord. Man, what a word. What a difficult word, Lord. All these judgments, what's coming upon this earth. This earth is so blinded, they don't even know what's coming. They don't know what's coming at them, Lord. And again, Lord, I just pray that as a church, that we would be that beacon, that light that shines in the darkness, that lights up the world around us. That we would warn people, and that we would love people. And I pray that they would see the grace in us, and I pray that they would also see the reverence for the holiness of our God. Because both are necessary. And Lord, we love you, and we praise you, and we thank you that we have hope. Your hope, that we have Jesus. And I pray if there's anyone here, or if there's anyone listening or watching online, God, I pray if they haven't accepted you as Lord and Savior, that they would do that right now, not waste another second. The time is short. Jesus is coming again soon. And so I pray that they would just bow their hearts, the knee of their hearts, and say, "Lord Jesus, I confess I'm a sinner. And I repent right now of my sins, and I turn to Jesus. Lord, I need you in my life. I want you in my life. And I open myself up now for you to come in and take over. Thank you, Lord, for your forgiveness. I believe that you died for my sins, you were buried, and you rose again on the third day. And I trust in you for my salvation. In Jesus' name." And Lord, thank you for the rest of us who have salvation. Thank you for that salvation. Wow. One day we're going to reign with you as kings and priests over this earth. Amazing. We love you, Lord, and we praise you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Communion is one of those, you know, just incredibly sacred things, very meaningful things. And Scripture tells us, it says that a man ought to examine himself before he eats of the bread or drinks of the cup. For anyone who eats of the bread without recognizing the body of the Lord eats and drinks judgment on himself. That just goes to show just how we should just have reverence for it. We should just value the opportunity that we even have to take communion and what we do with it. The Bible says, it says, "For I've received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.'" Let's pray. Lord God, I just thank you, Lord, that we have this opportunity to take communion. Lord, I just pray that each and every one of us, it just touches our heart, Lord, that we do this in remembrance of you. We're studying through this book of Revelation, and it just seems so hard and painful what the world is going to go through. But Lord, it's just your mercy, your grace, your perfect judgment. Everything is working together, Lord, and we can't fathom what you have in store for us, but we know that Jesus Christ, that you came and you died for us, and you're telling us over and over and over again, it's like, I love you more than you can fathom. My body was broken for you, and it's a free gift that we all get to accept. But there will still be those who just absolutely reject it. And we just can't, as Christians, we just don't understand why. And Lord, I just pray right now, Lord, as we take this bread, Lord, that we will take it, Lord, in reverence, Lord, in appreciation and gratitude for what you did for us. And we pray this in Jesus' precious name. Amen. You may take It says, "In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whoever eats this bread and drinks this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.'" Let's pray. Lord Jesus, this is the new covenant. Lord, and it's just amazing that the shedding of your blood washes us as white as snow before your Father and our Father in heaven. Lord, you did this for us. Your body was beaten and bruised. Your blood was shed because you are that perfect sacrifice. Nothing else can save us. It's only the shedding of your blood, the perfect atonement, the only atonement for our sin. And as we take this cup, Lord, may we forever be grateful. May we forever be in remembrance of you and what you did for us. May we forever proclaim that you are Lord and Savior to this world in which we live. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Amen. You may take the cup.
The sun.